Hi friends, Helen McCrane here again. Now, those of you who love reading to children are almost undoubtedly aware of the name E.B. White, the author of numerous wonderful books for kids, the most famous of which, arguably, is Charlotte's Web, the story of a barn spider named Charlotte, who saves a pig named Wilbur from certain slaughter. Now, she does this by weaving into her wondrous web actual words describing Wilbur to the humans that own him. Now, the inspiration for this story came from the fact that E.B. White was not only a terrific writer, but he was a farmer who owned a farm in Maine on which he raised, among other things, I suspect, pigs, one of which died an untimely death. And in 1948, White wrote about this incident in an essay for that most grown-up publication, The Atlantic Magazine. And it is that essay that I am going to read for you now. I spent several days and nights in mid-September with an ailing pig, and I feel driven to account for this stretch of time, more particularly since the pig died at last and I lived, and things might easily have gone the other way round, and none left to do the accounting. Even now, so close to the event, I cannot recall the hour sharply, and am not ready to say whether death came on the third night or the fourth night. And this uncertainty afflicts me with a sense of personal deterioration. If I were in decent health, I should know how many nights I sat up with a pig. The scheme of buying a spring pig in blossom time, feeding it through the summer and fall, and butchering it when the solid cold weather arrives, is a familiar scheme to me and follows an antique pattern. It is a tragedy, enacted on most farms with perfect fidelity to the original script. The murder, being premeditated, is in the first degree, but it is quick and skillful, and the smoked bacon and ham provide a ceremonial ending whose fitness is seldom questioned. Now, once in a while, something slips, and one of the actors goes up in his lines, and the whole performance stumbles and halts. My pig simply failed to show up for a meal. The alarm spread rapidly. The classic outline of the tragedy was lost, and I found myself cast suddenly in the role of a pig's friend and physician, a farcical character with an enema bag for a prop. I had a presentiment the very first afternoon that the play would never regain its balance, and that my sympathies were now wholly with the pig. This was slapstick, the sort of dramatic treatment which instantly appealed to my old dachshund, Fred, who joined the vigil, held the bag, and when all was over, presided at the interment. And when we slid the body into the grave, we both were shaken to the core. The loss we felt was not the loss of ham, but the loss of pig. He had evidently become precious to me. Not that he represented a distant nourishment in a hungry time, but that he had suffered in a suffering world. But I'm running ahead of my story, and shall have to go back. My pig pen is at the bottom of an old orchard below the house. The pigs I have raised have lived in a faded building which was once an ice house. There's a pleasant yard to move about in, shaded by an apple tree, which overhangs the low rail fence. A pig couldn't ask for anything better, or none has, at any rate. The sawdust in the ice house makes a comfortable bottom in which to root and a warm bed. This sawdust, however, came under suspicion when the pig took sick. One of my neighbors said he thought the pig would have done better on new ground, the same principle that applies in planting potatoes. He said there might be something unhealthy about that sawdust, that he never thought well of sawdust. It was about 4 o'clock in the afternoon when I first noticed there was something wrong with the pig. He failed to appear at the trough for his supper, and when a pig, or a child, refuses supper, a chill wave of fear runs through any household, or ice household. After examining my pig, who was stretched out in the sawdust inside the building, I went to the phone and cranked it 4 times. Mr. Henderson answered. "What's good for a sick pig?" I asked. There is never any identification needed on a country phone. The person on the other end knows who's talking by the sound of the voice and by the character of the question.
"I don't know. I never had a sick pig," said Mr. Henderson. "But I can find out quick enough. You hang up, and I'll call Irving."
Mr. Henderson was back on the line in 5 minutes.
"Irving says roll him over on his back and give him 2 ounces of castor oil, or sweet oil. And if that doesn't do the trick, give him an injection of soapy water. He says he's almost sure the pig's plugged up. And even if he's wrong, it can't do no harm."
I thank Mr. Henderson. I didn't go right down to the pig, though. I sank into a chair and sat still for a few minutes to think about my troubles. And then I got up and went to the barn, catching up on some odds and ends that needed tending to. Unconsciously, I held off for an hour, the deed by which I would officially recognize the collapse of the performance of raising a pig. I wanted no interruption in the regularity of feeding, the steadiness of growth, the even succession of days. I wanted no interruption, no oil, no deviation. I just wanted to keep on raising a pig. Full meal after full meal, spring into summer into fall. And I didn't even know whether there were 2 ounces of castor oil on the place. Shortly after 5 o'clock, I remembered that we had been invited out to dinner that night and realized that if I were to dose a pig, there was no time to lose. The dinner date seemed a familiar conflict. I move in a desultory society, and often a week or two will roll by without my going to anybody's house to dinner or anybody's coming to mine. But when an occasion does arise and I am summoned, something usually turns up an hour or two in advance to make all human intercourse seem vastly inappropriate. I have come to believe that there is in hostesses a special power of divination, and that they deliberately arrange dinners to coincide with pig failure or some other sort of failure. At any rate, it was after 5 o'clock, and I knew I could put off no longer the evil hour. When my son and I arrived in the pig yard, armed with a small bottle of castor oil and a length of clothesline, the pig had emerged from his house and was standing in the middle of the yard listlessly. He gave us a slim greeting. I could see that he felt uncomfortable and uncertain. I had brought the clothesline, thinking I'd have to tie him. The pig weighed more than 100 pounds. But we never used it. My son reached down, grabbed both front legs, and upset him quickly. And when he opened his mouth to scream, I turned the oil into his throat. A pink, corrugated area I had never seen before. I had just time to read the label while the neck of the bottle was in his mouth. It said, "Pure test." The screams, slightly muffled by oil, were pitched in the hysterically high range of pig sound, as though torture were being carried out. But they didn't last long. It was all over rather suddenly, and his legs released, the pig righted himself. In the upset position, the corners of his mouth had been turned down, giving him a frowning expression. Back on his feet again, he regained the set smile that a pig wears, even in sickness. He stood his ground, sucking slightly at the residue of oil. A few drops leaked out of his lips, while his wicked eyes, shaded by their coy little lashes, turned on me in disgust and hatred. I scratched him gently with oily fingers, and he remained quiet, as though trying to recall the satisfaction of being scratched when in health, and seeming to rehearse in his mind the indignity to which he had just been subjected. I noticed, as I stood there, 4 or 5 small dark spots on his back near the tail end, reddish-brown in color, each about the size of a housefly. I could not make out what they were. They did not look troublesome, but at the same time they did not look like mere surface bruises or chafe marks. Rather, they seem blemishes of internal origin. His stiff white bristles almost completely hid them, and I had to part the bristles with my fingers to get a good look. Several hours later, a few minutes before midnight, having dined well and at someone else's expense, I returned to the pig house with a flashlight. The patient was asleep. Kneeling, I felt his ears, as you might put a hand on the forehead of a child. And they seemed cool. And then, with the light, made a careful examination of the yard and the house for sign of that the oil had worked. I found none and went to bed. We'd been having an unseasonable spell of weather. Hot, close days with fog settling in every night, scaling for a few hours in midday and then creeping back again at dark, drifting in first over the trees on the point and then suddenly blowing across the fields, blotting out the world and taking possession of houses, men, and animals. Everyone kept hoping for a break, but the break failed to come. Next day was another hot one. I visited the pig before breakfast and tried to tempt him with a little milk in his trough. He just stared at it, while I made a sucking sound through my teeth to remind him of past pleasures of the feast. With very small, timid pigs, weanlings, this ruse is often quite successful and will encourage them to eat, but with a large, sick pig, the ruse is senseless, and the sound I made must have made him feel, if anything, more miserable. He not only did not crave food, he felt a positive revulsion to it. I found a place under the apple tree where he had vomited in the night. And at this point, although a depression had settled over me, I didn't suppose that I was going to lose my pig. From the lustiness of a healthy pig, a man derives a feeling of personal lustiness, the stuff that goes into his trough and is received with such enthusiasm is an earnest of some later feast of his own, and when this suddenly comes to an end and the food lies stale and untouched, souring in the sun, the pig's imbalance becomes the man's, vicariously. And life seems insecure, displaced, transitory. As my own spirits declined, along with the pig's, the spirits of my vile old dachshund rose. The frequency of our trips down the footpath through the orchard to the pigyard delighted him, although he suffers greatly from arthritis and moves with difficulty and would be bedridden if he could find anyone willing to serve him meals on a tray. He never missed a chance to visit the pig with me, and he made many professional calls on his own. You could see him down there at all hours, his white face parting the grass along the fence as he wobbled and stumbled about, his stethoscope dangling, a happy quack, writing his villainous prescriptions and grinning his corrosive grin. And when the enema bag appeared and the bucket of warm suds, his happiness was complete, and he managed to squeeze his enormous body between the two lowest rails of the yard, and then assumed full charge of the irrigation. Once, when I lowered the bag to check the flow, he reached in and hurriedly drank a few mouthfuls of the suds to test its potency. I have noticed that Fred will feverishly consume any substance that is associated with trouble. The bitter flavor is to his liking. And when the bag was above reach, he concentrated on the pig and was everywhere at once, a tower of strength and inconvenience. The pig, curiously enough, stood rather quietly through this colonic carnival, and the enema, though ineffective, was not as difficult as I had anticipated. I discovered, though, that once having given a pig an enema, there is no turning back, no chance of resuming one of life's more stereotyped roles. The pig's lot and mine were inextricably bound now, as though the rubber tube were the silver cord. And from then on until the time of his death, I held the pig steadily in the bowl of my mind. The task of trying to deliver him from his misery became a strong obsession. His suffering soon became the embodiment of all earthly wretchedness. Long toward the end of the afternoon, defeated in physicking, I phoned the veterinary, and 20 miles away, and placed the case formally in his hands. He was full of questions, and when I mentioned the dark spots on the pig's back, his voice changed its tone.
"I don't want to scare you," he said, "but when there are spots, erysipelas has to be considered."
Together we considered erysipelas, with frequent interruptions from the telephone operator, who wasn't sure the connection had been established. "If a pig has erysipelas, can he give it to a person?" I asked.
"Yes, he can,"
replied the vet.
"Have they answered?"
asked the operator. "Yes, they have," I said. Then I addressed the vet again. "You better come over here and examine this pig right away."
"Well, I can't come myself," said the vet. "But MacDonald can come this evening, if that's all right. Mac knows more about pigs than I do anyway. You needn't worry too much about the spots. To indicate erysipelas, they would have to be deep hemorrhagic infarcts."
"Deep hemorrhagic what?" I asked.
"Infarcts," said the vet. "Have they answered?"
asked the operator. "Well," I said, "I don't know what you'd call these spots, except that they're about the size of a house fly. And if the pig has erysipelas, I guess I have it too by this time, because, well, we've been very close lately."
"MacDonald will be over,"
said the vet. It was long after dark, and the supper dishes had been put away, when a car drove in and MacDonald got out. He had a girl with him. I could just make her out in the darkness. She seemed young and pretty. "This is Miss Wyman," he said. "We've been having a picnic supper on the shore. That's why I'm late." MacDonald stood in the driveway and stripped off his jacket, then his shirt. His stocky arms and capable hands showed up in my flashlight's gleam as I helped him find his coverall and get zipped up. The rear seat of his car contained an astonishing amount of paraphernalia, which he soon overhauled, selecting a chain, a syringe, a bottle of oil, a rubber tube, and some other things I couldn't identify. Miss Wyman said she'd go along with us and see the pig. I led the way down the warm slope of the orchard, my light picking out the path for them, and we all three climbed the fence, entered the pig house, and squatted by the pig, while MacDonald took a rectal reading. My flashlight picked up the glitter of an engagement ring on the girl's hand. No elevation, said MacDonald, twisting the thermometer in the light. You needn't worry about erysipelas. He ran his hand slowly over the pig's stomach, and at one point the pig cried out in pain.
Poor Piggly Wiggly, said Miss Wyman.
The treatment I had been giving the pig for 2 days was then repeated, somewhat more expertly, by the doctor, Miss Wyman and I handing him things as he needed them, holding the chain that he had looped around the pig's upper jaw, holding the syringe, holding the bottle stopper, the end of the tube, all of us working in darkness and in comfort, working with the instinctive teamwork induced by emergency conditions, the pig unprotesting, the house shadowy, protecting, intimate. I went to bed tired, but with a feeling of relief that I had turned over part of the responsibility of the case to a licensed doctor. I was beginning to think, though, that the pig was not going to live. He died 24 hours later. Or it might have been 48. There is a blur in time here, and I may have lost or picked up a day in the telling, and the pig one in the dying. At intervals during the last day, I took cool, fresh water down to him, and at such times as he found the strength to get to his feet, he would stand with his head in the pail and snuffle his snout around. He drank a few sips, but no more. Yet it seemed to comfort him to dip his nose in water and bobble it about, sucking in and blowing out through his teeth. Much of the time now he lay indoors, half buried in sawdust. Once, near the last, while I was attending him, I saw him try to make a bed for himself. But he lacked the strength, and when he set his snout into the dust, he was unable to plow even the little furrow he needed to lie down in. He came out of the house to die. When I went down before going to bed, he lay stretched in the yard, a few feet from the door. I knelt down, saw that he was dead, and left him there. His face had a mild look, expressive neither of deep peace nor of deep suffering, although I think he had suffered a good deal. I went back up to the house and to bed, and cried internally, deep, hemorrhagic, in tears. I didn't wake till nearly 8 the next morning, and when I looked out the open window, the grave was already being dug down beyond the dump under a wild apple. I could hear the spade strike against the small rocks that blocked the way. Never send to know for whom the grave is dug, I said to myself. It is dug for thee. Fred, I knew well, was supervising the work of digging, so I ate breakfast slowly. It was a Saturday morning, and the thicket in which I found the gravediggers at work was dark and warm, the sky overcast. here among alders and young hackamacks, at the foot of the apple tree, Howard had dug a beautiful hole, 5 feet long, 3 feet wide, 3 feet deep. He was standing in it, removing the last spadefuls of earth, while Fred patrolled the brink in simple but impressive circles, disturbing the loose earth of the mound so that it trickled back in. There had been no rain in weeks, and the soil, even 3 feet down, was dry and powdery. As I stood and stared, an enormous earthworm that had been partially exposed by the spade at the bottom dug itself deeper and made a slow withdrawal, seeking even remoter moistures at even lonelier depths. And just as Howard stepped out and rested his spade against the tree and lit a cigarette, a small green apple separated itself from a branch overhead and fell into the hole. Everything about this last scene seemed overwritten. The dismal sky, the shabby woods, the imminence of rain, the worm, legendary bedfellow of the dead, the apple, conventional garnish of a pig. But even so, there was a directness and dispatch about animal burial, I thought, that made it a more decent affair than human burial. There was no stopover in the undertaker's foul parlor, no wreath, nor spray. And when we hitched a line to the pig's hind legs and dragged him swiftly from his yard, throwing our weight into the harness and leaving a wake of crushed grass and smooth rubble over the dump, ours was a businesslike procession, with Fred, the dishonorable pallbearer, staggering along in the rear, his perverse bereavement showing in every seam in his face. And the post-mortem, performed handily and swiftly, right at the edge of the grave, so that the inwards which had caused the pig's death preceded him into the ground, and he lay at last resting squarely on the cause of his own doing. I threw in the first shovelful, and then we worked rapidly and without talk until the job was complete. I picked up the rope and made it fast to Fred's collar. He is a notorious ghoul. And we all three filed back up the path to the house, Fred bringing up the rear and holding back every inch of the way, feigning unusual stiffness. I noticed that although he weighed far less than the pig, he was harder to drag, being possessed of the vital spark. The news of the death of my pig traveled fast and far, and I received many expressions of sympathy from friends and neighbors, for no one took the event lightly, and the premature expiration of a pig is, I soon discovered, a departure which the community marks solemnly on its calendar, a sorrow in which it feels fully involved. I have written this account in penitence and in grief, as a man who failed to raise his pig, and to explain my deviation from the classic course of so many raised pigs. The grave in the woods is unmarked, but Fred can direct the mourner to it unerringly and with immense goodwill. And I know he and I shall often revisit it, singly and together. In seasons of reflection and despair. On flagless memorial days of our own choosing.